Hello, people. What is up? Here we are back to some PChem. Are you excited? I know that I am. Hopefully, you guys can hear me okay. And yeah, let's get back into it. So, we ended before the break almost 2 weeks ago. actually, more than 2 weeks ago. We ended chapter four. Okay, we came up with a spontaneous, or a way to determine whether or not a process would be spontaneous using this idea of entropy, okay? So let's get back to this general question of spontaneity. Okay, this general question of spontaneity, we've come up with a way to determine if a process will be spontaneous by looking at the delta S of the universe. And the delta S of the universe is equal to the delta S of the system plus the delta S of the surroundings. Okay, you remember this. This is all recalling chapter 13, three. Okay? The spontaneity of a process is determined by this chunk here, okay, where we decided that delta S universe is greater than zero for spontaneous processes. Okay? So this is our spontaneity test. Delta S universe is greater than zero for a spontaneous process. The problem with that is that these pieces here are not always convenient to measure. Okay, they're not convenient. Especially delta S surroundings. Especially delta S surroundings. Okay, it's very difficult to figure out how much entropy is being pumped into the surroundings, and therefore it's very difficult to measure delta S universe. So we need to come up with a different way to do this. We want something that's a little bit easier and that has nothing to do with the surroundings and only has to do with the system, okay? So what we want something that is, I guess, we want a spontaneous criteria that's dependent on only the system. Okay? We want something that depends only on the system, and we don't have to worry about the surroundings. We also have noticed or note that when we derived delta S system, I don't know if you guys remember this, this was a couple weeks ago. When we derived this this equation here, this representation of delta S system, we used it, or the way that we derived this is by assuming that the system was isolated. Okay, so we assumed an isolated system here. And when a system is isolated, what does that mean? First of all, it means that there is no PV work allowed, okay? No PV work. That means that in this case, W is equal to zero, okay? Not only that, but for an isolated system, by definition, it must be adiabatic, okay? It's not transferring any sort of heat across the across that barrier, so that for Q must be zero. Okay. These cases here, W of zero and Q equal to zero, they are not at all practical. Okay, these are not experimental conditions. And this is a problem. This is a problem because we want to be able to define the spontaneity of a particular reaction that we're looking at. Okay? So we need to define a new way of describing the spontaneity of a process. using realistic conditions. Okay, so let's figure out what those realistic conditions should be. Most processes are going to have. Sorry, let me write this up. Realistic conditions. Most processes that are occurring in the lab or that we consider to be useful or interesting to talk about are going to have constant P and constant T. Okay? These are the normal realistic conditions that we should expect. Okay? Given that in this case we can't have, or we have W of 0 and a Q of 0, those are just too difficult of conditions to have. So we want to have some sort of condition where we have constant P and constant T and define spontaneity in terms of those realistic conditions. Okay? So we're going to define two new energies to try to get to that point. Okay? The first is the Helmholtz. Let's define two new energies. The Helmholtz energy okay. Helmholtz energy is defined as A is equal to U minus TS. Okay, that's the Helmholtz. And the second energy that we're going to define is the Gibbs energy. And G is defined as H minus TS. Okay? So what we want to do now is determine if either of these give a better spontaneous criteria. Do either of these give a better spontaneous criteria than what we've already determined with the entropy? Okay. To figure this out, we need to first let's first look at the Helmholtz energy. Okay, so we have A is defined as U minus TS. We want to look at an infinitesimal change in the Helmholtz free energy, or the Helmholtz energy, which would be given by dA, right? dA is equal to dU minus TdS minus SdT, where this portion here, recall back from a couple chapters ago, this part being broken into these, is an effect of the chain rule. Okay, so there we have the infinitesimal change in A. And we can define for a reversible process. Okay, we can define for a reversible process if we substitute in something for du, that's only true for reversible processes. Okay, and this is actually derived in section 4.2. But what is derived is that du is equal to negative p dv plus t ds, okay? And I'll let you guys go to section 4.2 and actually check that derivation yourself, okay? So I'm going to plug this value of du in this equation here, and we're going to find that dA is equal to negative p dv plus t ds minus TdS minus SdT. TdS is cancel out, and we're left with dA is equal to negative PdV minus SdT. Okay, for this expression, since we have a dV and a dT here, okay, dV and dT, these mean that specifically for A, oops, can't have that. Trying to make this all black. Therefore, what are called the natural variables Okay, natural variables of A are V and T. Okay, so the natural, this is just a term that's used for these state functions. A natural variable are variables that are used within the state function that tend to work out really, really well. Okay, and in this expression, you can see that the natural variables for dA are given by the two values that are allowed to change. Okay, so if we set this process, okay, so if we set a process for to delta T equals zero, so isothermal, and delta V equals zero, so isochoric. If we have a delta T equals zero and a delta, V equals zero process, both of these terms become zero, yeah? And we end up with an expression dA is less than or equal to zero. Okay? But this isn't quite good enough, right? Because in these, if we make this distinction here for this process, where T and V are delta T and delta V are zero, that means that they are constant. Okay, so we can write this even more explicitly as dA with constant V and constant T is less than or equal to zero. Okay, so this is a spontaneity criteria for processes that have constant volume and constant temperature. Okay. This isn't quite what we want. We want something that has constant pressure and constant temperature, but this is getting close. Okay, so anytime you have a system that has constant volume and constant temperature, for example, a bomb calorimeter, this is an excellent way to determine whether or not a process is spontaneous or not. Okay, but this isn't as applicable as if we had constant pressure and constant temperature. So let's figure out what happens with G. Okay, so let's try G. Oops. Okay, let's try G. G is defined as H minus TS. If we look at an infinitesimal change in G, we get an infinitesimal change in H minus T dS minus S dT. Okay. Looks pretty familiar. And here we're going to substitute in another expression that's derived in section 4.2 for dH, and it's found that dH is equal to VdP plus TdS. And again, you guys should go to section 4.2 and read through and see how this is derived. I'm gonna plug this back in up here and go forward. dG is equal to, plug this guy in, VdP plus TdS minus TdS minus S dT. Again, we have some cancellations occur, and we end up with dG is equal to VdP minus S dT. Okay. Now, let's take a close look at this equation that we've got here. Notice that the natural variables for this equation end up being P and T, which is exactly what we want for our spontaneous criteria. Okay, so here within this we have T and P as natural variables. Okay, and therefore if we set those equal to, or the change of those variables equal to zero, so for an isobaric process and an isothermal process, okay, both of these are equal to zero, that means that we have a new spontaneous criteria, or spontaneity criteria, that's given by the change in G with respect to constant T and P is less than or equal to 0. Okay. Now, this is a very useful representation or spontaneous criteria because it uses conditions that are very common for processes that we would be doing in normal everyday labs. Okay. For example, let's just jump the gun here and assume, we're going to step forward quite a few steps and just say, all right, based on this, let's just come up with spontaneity designations for DG, okay? So just like we did for delta S in the third law of thermodynamics, for a system with constant T and P, okay, for a system with constant T and P, if the delta G for this process is less than 0, the process is spontaneous. Okay? If delta G is greater than 0, the process is not spontaneous. Okay? And when you have delta G equal to 0, the system is said to be at equilibrium. Okay? So now we have a much more simple and practical way of determining whether or not a process will be spontaneous using delta G. Okay, so the change in the Gibbs energy. Note that both A and G are state functions. Okay, they're both state functions. So that means if we integrate them, so if I integrate dG, I get delta G. If I integrate dA, I get delta A. Okay. That means that we have four total state functions that define independent energy quantities. Okay. So state functions that define independent energy quantities are U, starting out first law, H, A, and G. Okay, U, H, A, and G. So we have total internal energy, the enthalpy, Helmholtz energy, and Gibbs energy. Okay, and these are all, I guess they're the only independent state functions that can be defined using P, V, T, and S. Okay, so the only four independent state functions that can be defined with pressure, volume, temperature, and entropy. Let's do a quick summary of all four of these. Okay, so I'll do the energy quantity here. And over here, I'll do the natural variables. Okay, because each of these have their own set of natural variables. Starting with dU. dU is equal to negative P dV plus T dS. Again, this is derived in section 4.2. The natural variables for this expression or for this energy are volume and entropy. Okay. Next, enthalpy, dH. This is not height, by the way, Madison and Sean. dH is defined as dVP plus T dS. Okay, natural variables here, pressure and entropy. Next, Helmholtz energy. negative s dt minus, or negative p dv. The natural variables here are t and v. And finally, the Gibbs energy, negative s dt plus v dp. And in this case, the natural variables are t and p. Okay. So this is just a good summary for you guys to keep track of all four of these energy quantities. So going back up to this idea, the nice thing about this, by the way, is I can just scroll up. You know, I never have to, erase. I can scroll up. It's awesome. Okay. So in a, going back to this idea of defining spontaneity using delta G, okay, using delta G. So if I have delta G less than zero, what does that actually mean? What does having a spontaneous process actually mean? So say I have some process delta G less than zero. What does it mean? What does it mean to have a spontaneous process? It just means simply that the process will occur. Okay. All it means is that the process will occur. It says nothing about the speed. Okay, there is no mention of speed. So let's think about this. What does that actually mean? Process being spontaneous has nothing to do with speed. Let's look at an example of this. Okay. So if we look at the reaction between hydrogen gas and oxygen gas to produce liquid water. Okay. This reaction, it turns out, has an extremely negative delta H. Or, excuse me, delta G. Has a very negative delta G. But you can keep these guys in a container, so O2 and H2 can exist for millennia. Before they react. Okay? They can exist together for millennia before reacting, which tells us that this reaction is extremely, extremely slow. Okay? Even though it has an extremely spontaneous delta G, and we would predict that the reaction does in fact occur, we have not connected delta G to reaction rate yet. Okay? It's coming, but we haven't done it yet. Okay, so for now, delta G has basically nothing to do with reaction speed. Okay? So that's kind of what this spontaneity idea means. It just means that it will occur. It doesn't mean that it occurs instantaneously. Okay? So there's a difference between spontaneously and instantaneously. Okay, let's look at each individual, individually look at the usefulness of each of these new energy equations, okay? So let's look at A first. It's going to take me a bit of time to get used to drawing on this on this tablet rather than on the board. You guys are going to have to stick with me. Okay. Okay, so if we go back to the first law, okay, recall from the first law that du is equal to dq plus dw. Okay? So that's the infinitesimal change in the heat, and that's the infinitesimal change in the work. Gives us the infinitesimal change in the internal energy of the system. Okay. Also recall that ds is greater than or equal to dq over t. Okay, we can rearrange this into t ds is less than or equal to dq. Oops, dq. Okay, and we're going to plug this guy back in up here and see what happens. Okay, now we have du minus t ds is less than or equal to dw. Okay. Let's set delta t equal to 0 at this point, okay? So let's set delta t equal to 0. When I set delta t equal to 0, I can take out this d between the u and the s, okay? So I can write this now as du minus ts, okay, is less than or equal to the change in the work. And the reason that this is useful is because this whole internal piece is the definition of A. So now I can say that the change in A is less than or equal to the change in the work. If I integrate both sides, I get delta A is less than or equal to the work. Okay? By the way, the equal to part of this is for reversible processes. Okay. So remembering that work done on surroundings, by the way, this is work sys does on surroundings, okay? That is always negative, okay? Because it's in reference to the system itself. So since delta A must be less than the work that the system does on the surroundings, that means that delta A is providing a maximal amount of work sys can do on the surroundings. Okay? So delta A is providing the maximal amount of work that system can possibly do on the surroundings. But remember that this is only true for an isothermal process. Okay? Fun fact here. Fun fact. Well, maybe we should do this in a fun color because it's a fun fact. What fun color? How about pink? We'll do pink. Fun fact. Fun fact. So Helmholtz is a German. You would never guess, right, from a name like that. He's a German dude. And actually, the word for work in German is Arbeit. Arbeit, okay? That's the German word for work, which is why Helmholtz represents this energy with an A. Stands for Arbeit, okay? We have up here the change in the energy, the maximum change in the energy. Is equal to or greater than the work. Okay, so that's why Helmholtz came up with this A, and if you ever wondered why it's given A, because he's German. Okay, fun fact over. Okay, let's do something similar for delta G, except I am going to introduce an idea here where we are going to assume that non-PV work can be done, okay? So let's do this for G, but include non-PV work, okay? When we include non-PV work, which we're going to call W non-PV, very original, I know,
We have to go all the way back to the first law and redefine the first law, okay? Because if you remember, the first law is given by dq plus the change in the work, okay? But now we have two different forms of work. We have the work that's done with PV stuff, so that's a change in pressure and volume, and we have work that's not a PV. So it doesn't have anything to do with the change in pressure and volume, but work is still done. Okay, so this is a restatement of the first law, taking into account the fact that work can be non-PV. Okay, and again, we're going to use this idea that dS is greater than or equal to dQ over T. Okay, we're going to use this. And we're going to use W is equal to negative P dV. Okay, that's the PV work. Okay, so now we can rearrange this whole piece up here using these two substitutions, and we can write this as dU. dU plus P dV minus T dS is less than or equal to dW non PV. Okay. Now, at this point, I'm going to assume or set the conditions that P and T are constants. Okay. Now, from now on, when you see that P and T and constant are constant, you should immediately start to think delta G. Okay? Because these are the perfect conditions for delta G. Now, we're setting P and T constant here. What does that mean for this above expression? That means that I can take, again, this D outside, and I can write this as U plus PV minus TS is less than or equal to DW non-PV. Okay. This part here is H. Okay, so we can substitute in H there. Now we have dH minus TS is less than or equal to dW non-PV. Okay, now we have G, and we can substitute that in. So we have dG at constant TP is less than or equal to dW non-PV. Okay, we can integrate both sides, just like with A, and we get delta G is less than or equal to the non-PV work. Okay, and again, non-PV work, just like PV work, is negative for system, the work that a system does on surroundings. Okay, so since this is less than or equal to, that means that this delta G provides a maximal amount of non-PV work. Delta G is okay, so the delta G provides a maximum value for the non-PV work that can be done. Okay. And again, up here, the equal to is for reversible processes. Okay? Cool. Now, since many processes are isothermal, it's useful to define both A and G in terms of an isothermal system, okay? Since delta T equals zero is common, it makes sense to actually come up with expressions for both A, or delta A and delta G under these conditions, okay? So let's do A first. A is defined as U minus TS. Okay. If we look at the infinitesimal change in A, this is equal to dU minus TdS minus SdT. Since it's isothermal, this goes to zero, and we end up with delta A is equal to delta U minus T delta S for the integrated form. Okay? Let's do the same for G. G is defined as H minus TS. The infinitesimal change in G is equal to dH minus T dS minus S dT. Again, this is an isothermal process, so S dT goes to zero. And after integrating, we end up with delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. Okay? So whenever you have a process that is isothermal, you can use either of these two expressions to determine what delta A or what delta G is. Okay, fair enough. I suggest you read through those first three sections of the textbook up to 4.3 and do each of the examples that are in the book. They're quite helpful, and I think that they will help you immensely in understanding the contents of this chapter. Okay, we'll pick up there on Wednesday, and I'll see you then. Take care.